The conch is introduced at the beginning of the first chapter when Piggy and Ralph stumble across it by chance as they spot something creamy lying among the ferny weeds in the lagoon. Piggy is the first to identify it by name and to introduce the idea that it can be used as an instrument to summon people. "I've seen one like that before, on someone's back wall. A conch," he called it. "He used to blow it and then his mum would come. It's ever so valuable." Piggy is also the first to spot its potential value, although this is initially only in monetary terms. "A conch, ever so expensive. I bet if you wanted to buy one, you'd have to pay pounds and pounds and pounds." And he is immediately protective of it as he senses its fragility. "Careful, you'll break it." Ralph's interest is also piqued by the shell, but it's clear that at least initially he does not see the same value in it as Piggy, as he seems to regard it purely as a toy, which will perhaps distract him for a short while. The shell was interesting and pretty and a worthy plaything. Although it's Piggy's idea to use the conch for the practical purpose of signalling to the boys who are dispersed throughout the jungle, "We can use this to call the others. Have a meeting. They'll come when they hear us. It is Ralph who is the one to blow it, because Piggy's asthma prevents him. And it's also ultimately Ralph who will take credit for this." After several failed attempts where only a rushing sound came from its mouth but nothing more, Ralph at last manages a deep, harsh note, which boomed under the palms, spread through the intricacies of the forest and echoed back from the pink granite of the mountain. Clouds of birds rose from the treetops, and something squealed and ran in the undergrowth. He laid the conch against his lips, took a deep breath and blew once more. The note boomed again at his firmer pressure. The note, fluking up an octave, became a strident blare, more penetrating than before. As Ralph continues to blow the conch, more and more boys appear from the jungle and assemble on the beach. As all of the boys gather around him, Ralph subconsciously creates a connection between the physical presence of the conch and the abstract notion of leadership. He lifted the conch. "Seems to me we ought to have a chief to decide things." And it's at this point that the shell starts to take on symbolic meaning. The moment that Ralph picks up the shell and puts it to his lips to muster the boys is a pivotal moment, as it is his connection with it in their minds, that he is the one to blow it and that he is the one holding it when they all arrive, that will be the deciding factor in the vote for chief. But there was a stillness about Ralph as he sat that marked him out. There was his size and attractive appearance. And most obscurely, yet most powerfully, there was the conch. The being that had blown that, had sat waiting for them on the platform with a delicate thing balanced on his knees, was set apart. Early on in the novel, the boys play at replicating the society from which they have come, i.e., one with a democratically elected leader who sets the rules for civilized behaviour. Even if they do see it as a game in much the same way that Ralph imitates the adult world of war, when, as a fighter plane, he pretends to shoot Piggy down. This toy of voting was almost as pleasing as the conch. As newly elected leader, Ralph decides that we can't have everybody talking at once. We'll have to have hands up, like at school. Then I'll give them the conch. I'll give the conch to the next person to speak. He can hold it when he's speaking, and he won't be interrupted, except by me. The role of the conch and what it stands for continues to evolve. Initially, it's something to be played with, which then becomes a practical means of mustering the boys. After this, it becomes a tacit or unspoken symbol of leadership, until it's finally transformed into an overt instrument not only of democracy and its consequent freedom of speech, but also of law and order, which confers on whichever person is holding it the right to air their views without interruption, thus forcing the boys to listen with respect. In the beginning, the boys, even Jack, respect or at least make a show of respecting the shell and what it stands for. Piggy, partly recovered, pointed to the conch in Ralph's hands, and Jack and Simon fell silent. Here we can see that the conch gives the boys a concrete representation and a visual reminder of the abstract, intangible rules to which they must adhere. For Piggy, however, the conch and what it comes to symbolise is not a toy. As he lacks the required physical attractiveness and charisma to earn the boy's respect and attention on his own account, it allows him to be heard in a society that otherwise wouldn't listen to him. Without the shell, other more strident but less intelligent voices would have influence and power. Although Ralph has the charisma and, initially, the popular support to be leader, other leadership qualities such as the ability to think clearly and rationally are somewhat lacking in him. The instrument of the conch allows Piggy to put words in Ralph's mouth so that the discourse is more purposeful and steered towards their survival and rescue. Ralph felt the conch lifted from his lap. Then Piggy was standing cradling the great cream shell and the shouting died down. "You're hindering Ralph, you're not letting him get to the most important thing." Note the way in which Piggy was standing cradling the great cream shell. The verb cradling describing the gentle and protective act of enfolding something, usually a baby, in one's arms. This not only conveys Piggy's immediate desire to safeguard this means of having his voice heard, but perhaps also suggests the idea of democracy among the boys being in a state of infancy and thus needing to be nurtured in order to grow. Piggy, in fact, becomes the custodian of the shell. Note that he always carries it with him tucked under his arm whenever they leave camp, so that democracy can be practiced wherever they are on the island. A little air was moving over the mountain. Piggy came with it, in shorts and shirt, labouring cautiously out of the forest with the evening sunlight gleaming from his glasses. He held the conch under his arm. As it is, he constantly needs to remind the boys of this right to speak as they still try to shut him down, but the conch gives him the courage to stand up for himself. "I got the conch," said Piggy indignantly. "You let me speak." It's interesting to observe that Piggy uses the conch to protect not only his own right to speak, but also the right of other vulnerable people, such as the Littlans, even if what they say creates unease and tension within the group. For example, when the Littlan brings up his concerns about the snake. Piggy, at least, seems to be aware that overlooking the Littlan's right to speak would be the thin end of the wedge. If a precedent is set that some people are deemed unworthy of a voice from the very beginning, it's easier to gradually erode the rights of others who are seen to be marginalised, such as himself. We can get a good indication of the way that Golding feels about democracy from the way he describes the conch as the novel develops. In the first chapter, it is described as a thing of beauty. In colour, the shell was deep cream, touched here and there with fading pink. Between the point, worn away into a little hole, and the pink lips of the mouth, lay 18 inches of shell with a slight spiral twist and covered with a delicate embossed pattern. And when Ralph lifted the cream and pink shell to his knees, a sudden breeze scattered light over the platform. Note the way in which Golding connects the conch, and therefore democracy, with fresh air and light, suggesting its goodness. The conch, however, is as fragile as it is beautiful, and also suggests Golding's belief that democracy, and the perceived legitimacy of its leaders, is precarious. It needs to be worked at and should never be taken for granted, being as it is conditional on the consensus of the majority, and vulnerable to attack, even when it may seem strong. Golding reflects this idea in his description of the shell in Chapter 5, Beast from Water, as exposure to the air had bleached the yellow and pink to near white and transparency. It's now no longer solid, its transparency reminiscent of fragile substances such as glass, which are easily shattered. In Chapter 5, Beast from Water, Jack has whipped up the boys into a state of frenzy, declaring, "Bollocks to the rules. We're strong. We hunt. If there's a beast, we'll hunt it down. We'll close in and beat and beat and beat." Causing the boys to randomly scatter until they come together on the beach to reenact a hunt. Piggy encourages Ralph to blow the conch in an attempt to restore some kind of order, but Ralph senses the danger in this. "If I blow the conch and they don't come back, then we've had it. We shan't keep the fire going. We'll be like animals. We'll never be rescued." Ralph seems to understand that if the boys ignore the call, then the authority of the conch and all it stands for could be irreparably damaged. Piggy, who has tunnel vision as far as the conch is concerned, fundamentally disagrees, saying, "If you don't blow, we'll soon be animals anyway." Although he does waver, Ralph raised the conch to his lips and then lowered it, he ends up by trusting his gut instinct not to use it, and the boy's hysteria soon burns itself out, and some kind of calm is restored, if only temporarily. In Chapter 6, Beast from Air, the conch seems to have regained its power, as Ralph does not need to blow it to convene a meeting. Ralph took the conch from where it lay on the polished seat and held it to his lips. But then he hesitated and did not blow. He held the shell up instead and showed it to them and they understood. At this moment, Ralph's legitimacy as their leader is apparently accepted. Just a few pages later, however, Jack, bored of the game of democracy, frustrated by the rules which restrain his increasingly savage nature, and emboldened by his call to reject them in the previous chapter, makes his first overt stand against the shell when he realises that the advantages of rejecting it and what it stands for far outweigh any benefit there may be for him of buying into the idea of democracy. "Conch, conch," shouted Jack. "We don't need the conch anymore. We know who ought to say things. What good did Simon do speaking, or Bill, or Walter? It's time some people knew they've got to keep quiet and leave deciding things to the rest of us." Jack's rejection of freedom of speech and his assertion that some people's voices are of more value than others is a pivotal moment, as from this point onwards, the decline of the conch's power and the descent from a democratic society into an authoritarian dictatorship are inexorable. Ralph's own legitimacy as leader is conditional on the perceived legitimacy of the conch. If Jack can gain popular support in ditching the conch, then Ralph's entitlement to be considered the boy's leader is null and void, leaving the way open for him to unilaterally seize power. Ralph is only able to defuse the situation by appeasing Jack's desire for a beast-hunting expedition to the rocky tail end of the island. This giving way only averts this immediate threat to his leadership temporarily, however, effectively serving to weaken his position in the longer term, as it is this pile of rocks which will ultimately become Jack's stronghold and the seat of his authoritarian power. It's very possible that Golding had particular real-life figures in mind here. Before the start of the Second World War, Britain's Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, in his desire to avoid war with Germany at all costs, appeased Adolf Hitler in 1938 by signing the Munich Agreement, which basically handed over a region of Czechoslovakia, known as the Sudetenland, to the Nazis in exchange for Hitler's promise that he would make no further territorial demands in Europe. Only 1 year later, however, Hitler broke his promise when he invaded Poland, and Britain was forced into declaring war. The parallels between Neville Chamberlain and Ralph, and Adolf Hitler and Jack, can clearly be seen in this incident, as Ralph's concession to Jack will only make his attempts at power-grabbing more brazen later on. Piggy fails to understand that as soon as Jack breaks away and forms his own tribe, the conch has become an irrelevance. When Jack's tribe storms their camp in Chapter 10, The Shell and the Glasses, his initial thought is that they wanted the conch. His vision, already impaired by the breaking of his spectacles in Chapter 4, Painted Faces and Long Hair, he becomes, to all intents and purposes, blinded when Jack's tribe instead steals these so that they have the means of making fire. All he has left is his metaphorical blind faith in a democracy which no longer exists. Jack has no use for democracy with its freedom of speech and with all its checks and balances on behaviour, which is governed by our baser instincts. He therefore has no use for the conch. The chief led them away from the camp, trotting steadily, exulting in his achievement. He was a chief now in truth, and he made stabbing motions with his spear. From his left hand dangled Piggy's broken glasses. For Jack, it's his provision of fire for his tribe which cements his claim to be leader. Not only does it provide warmth and the means to roast the slaughtered pigs upon which the boys feast, but it is an elemental and savage force that empowers and unifies them. The final assembly takes place in Chapter 11, Castle Rock. Ralph's blowing of the conch is a largely empty gesture and is in stark contrast with the very first time the boys gathered together. Even though the forest re-echoed and birds lifted, crying out of the treetops as on that first morning ages ago, both ways the beach was deserted, until only three others stood before him. Piggy holds on to the democratic ideal to the very end. When he and Ralph make their way to the fort to confront Jack, Piggy is adamant that he is going to take the conch to show him the one thing he hasn't got, stubbornly refusing to accept that the conch's power only exists in the eye of the beholder. When they arrive, Piggy demands to be heard. He held up the conch and the booing sagged a little, then came up again to strength. When he shouts, "I tell you, I got the conch!" Surprisingly, there was silence now. The tribe were curious to hear what amusing things he might have to say. Though the way in which it's not the conch which makes them silent, but rather their desire to ridicule the person holding it. Piggy's fundamental error is in perceiving the conch with its fragile shining beauty as a talisman, an object which possesses almost magical powers that protects the holder from evil spirits, or in this case from the evil of authoritarianism. The idea of democracy is definitively destroyed when Piggy dies. It's fitting that he's holding the conch when Roger murders him. The rock struck Piggy a glancing blow from chin to knee. The conch exploded into a thousand white fragments and ceased to exist. Democracy cannot exist in a vacuum. It needs to be actively practiced by the majority of the members of a society to survive. Essentially, the conch is not a talisman. It has no intrinsic power. Its power in a functioning democracy has been bestowed upon it by consensus. And as soon as the majority rejects democracy, it loses its power and returns to its state as a mere shell. So it's no surprise that it does not protect Piggy from Roger's final assault. Thanks for watching. If you have any questions, please let me know in the comments section below and I'll do my best to answer them. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel for more videos on English language topics and exam techniques and English literature texts.